This is a plastic skull. It demonstrates the various osteotomies that are available to cut the bones of the face and reposition them. So for now, we're going to talk about the chin. So if you look at the front here, there's a way that you can go in through the mouth and you can cut this bone off right here. And then you can move this piece of bone forward to advance the chin. It does require small screws or little wires to hold it in place once it's been done. But with this type of cut, you can also correct a crooked chin. You can take a wedge out and rotate it. You can make the chin longer by moving it down and putting bone grafts or other material in here. You can also twist it. You could shorten the chin by making two parallel cuts, and you would take out the middle piece, like taking the meat out of a sandwich, and then you could shorten the entire chin complex vertically. So this is called a sliding genioplasty because it slides forward just like that, but then you have to fixate it to have it be solid, otherwise it'd be wiggling around. The blood supply to this comes from muscles underneath here that attach on the back. So when you slide it forward, it can actually improve the neck profile somewhat. Some people feel it may improve sleep apnea because it can tighten things up underneath here and open the airway. Some people have an overly prominent chin. So if it's too long vertically or too long front to back, you can go in with an incision underneath the chin with a round burr that spins around on a drill, and you can sand this part down with burr. You could sand it down vertically. You could sand it down this way if it was too prominent. I would say that of the people we see, more than 2/3 of them come in to have the chin enlarged. Most of them we put a chin implant in because it's a straightforward operation. It's a small operation with few complications. To actually cut the bone while that operation's available, and I also have a dental degree and all the specialized equipment and little screws, it's a longer operation, requires a little deeper level of anesthesia, and there are more potential complications. There is a nerve that comes out of the bone right where this hole is, on both sides. That's called the mental nerve, and it goes to the lower lip. So when we do these operations, it can get bruised during the surgery, and it can be temporarily out of function. Just like if I punched you in the arm really hard, your arm wouldn't move, it would be hurt, but I didn't cut any nerves in your arm if I punch you. So it's not unusual to have some temporary weakness of this nerve because it's right in the vicinity of where the cut has to be. Now when you do an osteotomy like this, the other important thing is you have to be aware of how long the roots are of the teeth. So if you make this cut too high up, you could cut right along the roots of some of these teeth. There are other demonstrations on this skull. This is a vertical osteotomy of the ramus of the mandible. This is called the ramus. If you do this type of cut, you can move the entire lower jaw back. So someone that has a very prominent lower jaw, sort of a Jay Leno type, you go in through the mouth. We have a side cutting saw that cuts sideways and makes this vertical cut, and then you can telescope the pieces. So you'd make this cut and you push this back. You can see how the whole jaw can be set back. And then these pieces heal together and the bone remodels. If you wanted to advance the jaw, that requires a different type of cut. That's the cut demonstrated on this side. This is called a sagittal osteotomy. Sagittal is this plane right here. And what you have to do is you split this bone. You split the ramus. It's called a bilateral, meaning both sides, sagittal split osteotomy of the mandible. So I've released these little clips to demonstrate a sagittal osteotomy. Sagittal is this plane. We have special saws that go in through the mouth and make cuts here and make a cut along the outer portion of the teeth inside. Then you put specialized instruments in here to split this back of a piece of the bone. Once you split it like this, you can advance the jaw forward. And these pieces of bone kiss and they heal back together. Sometimes we'll put little screws in to hold it in place. But this operation also has some complications. The nerve goes right through that area. See this little tuft of thread demonstrating the nerve? So you're splitting it right on the area of the nerve, and this can advance. But also when this advances, sometimes you can get some bony resorption of this part of the bone and lose some of the angle of the jaw. So it's a little tricky, but this is the way you can advance the jaw to move it forward. There are also operations where you can move the upper jaw forward or up or down or twist it. And that's what's demonstrated here. Going through the mouth, lifting the upper lip up, making a cut from first molar to first molar or beyond, you can put special saws in on the floor of the nose and you can cut right across the upper jaw this way and right across that way. And you can take the entire upper jaw piece and you can move it down, you can twist it, you can move it up. So some people that have what's called long face syndrome, when they smile, they have a really gummy smile. So you can actually shorten the upper jaw by making two parallel cuts and taking the middle piece out and then moving the entire jaw up like an elevator. To fixate this, it does require little tiny plates and screws that have to be put in to hold it in place while it's healing. But for those patients, it's really a good solution. Scars are virtually invisible because they're all inside the mouth for these operations. Even the scar under the chin to reduce a prominent chin with a burr, remember I talked about sanding this down, it's hidden underneath the chin. 90% of the population has a scar under the chin from falling down when they were a kid. So that scar heals very well. So you can go in, you can shorten the chin vertically by burring it down. Some people, their chin is too prominent. So you can go in from here and you can burr it down, as opposed to making this type of cut on the bone and moving it back. The problem is you'd have this bony prominence here, and it's hard to get at that to shave it down. Downtime is very short with this operation, burring or any of the chin things, about a week. Most people would be back in an office job. There's still some swelling at that point, but we're not changing the bite at all. So you can eat right away, take liquids and chew food, but there is some swelling in this area. Ice helps keep it at a minimum. So these are examples of two different types of chin implants. They're different sizes. You can see there's more projection on this one than this one. But what I really wanted to bring to your attention is this one's more flexible than this one, which is a little harder rubber. This is called a conform implant. It has all these little indentations, and the idea is that it's softer so that as it heals, it can conform to the chin a little bit better, because everyone's chin isn't shaped the same over here. So you can put these in and you can get it to conform, and it heals down and scar tissue holds it in place. The firmer implant also can be customized, so it really can achieve the same result, because you can carve out the back with a scalpel a little bit and make it fit these bumps better. Some people have more prominent bumps here on their chin than others, so at the time of the surgery, you can either sand the bumps down or you can trim the implant to customize it and put it in. I customize virtually every single implant when I put them in and trim various parts of it to get the best fit possible.